put out no ladies and gentlemen. The beauty of being the last speaker is that all you do is to summarize what others have said. So I'm just going to ride on Kudu's back and hang on to Mary's coat. And at the end of the day,
we all
land safely. Well, let me start by saying that when we talk of career, but I'm sure all of us here have something in mind. We want to make the best of the time we have on this earth. And at the end, we look back and say, yes, it's the worth our while. It's been an interesting journey. It's been an interesting race. And whatever your own decision or your own definition of success is, you say, yes, I have won that trust. Just like the fall. I want to start by showing you a 3-minute video. And that, to me, will capture everything Kule and Mary have discussed with you. So let's start with that.
What makes a top performer in the total rewards field? The World of Work Career Census asks that very question. It turns out there are 8 key differentiators, and they form the career excellence model for total rewards professionals. Just getting started in the field or want to keep your career moving? Here's what it takes.
Let's start with technical mastery. Sure, it's a fundamental, but top performers continue to develop their skills.
I think it's certainly a fundamental that practitioners have to have a thorough understanding of to apply to the work they're doing, but to really take it a step further, one needs to think outside of their own area of expertise or the technical analyses part of the role.
Next are 3 critical business skills. The first is analytical skills and attention to detail.
I think if we say that if we live and die by numbers, it's probably an understatement. We don't get a second chance. It's very important that those numbers are right.
Next is strategic business understanding.
Understanding your business, understanding the levers, you have a great advantage to understand what kind of risks management is going to take and at what time they're going to take those risks.
And communication and connection.
Telling a story is the way that the intent of a program comes across to people.
Telling the facts, being able to take a complicated subject and make it understandable to the average person.
Another important part of your professional development is your support system.
Find people that you can leverage for yourself in your life, whether inside the organization or outside, people who have walked the path, people you trust, people who can give you advice, and people who can ultimately help you clarify for yourself the best path forward.
There are 3 critical behaviors that top performers have mastered. The first is adaptability and flexibility.
You always need to be adaptable in the exec comm field. However, as things have gotten more complicated, more stakeholders, more involvement with shareholders and proxy groups, I think adaptability is more and more important. I see it as a crucial part of the job.
Then passion and proactivity.
Having a passion and being good at solving problems, that would qualify you for an entry level or an intermediate level compensation position. If you're looking for a more senior role, the next step in our growth is to be able to identify problems in the early stages and then work towards finding solutions.
And finally, continuous learning.
Having an outlook of continuous learning is important for the organizations you work for, so that you are fresh and you're sure that you have the new ways of thinking about a problem. But it's also important, I think, for you as an individual, because otherwise life can get really boring.
8 key differentiators to take your career to the next level. Going up.
You want to make progress in your career? You must think of technical skills.
Have the skills to prepare me on that job. You have to be analytical. It's not I did not do mathematics. I only read English. Being analytical does not necessarily mean playing with numbers. But being logical, being able to reason, being able to even write a story that flows. You also have to look at things from a strategic perspective. And you have to be a good communicator, because you're interacting with people, discussing with them, subordinates, peers, superiors. You also have to think of how do you support yourself in terms of development. I need to develop myself, but I need people who can help me in this process. And then the skills of being able to adapt. Environment is changing, work situation is changing, the way we work changing. Can I adapt if I want to make progress? Then I must have passion for what I do. And finally, say you must continuously develop yourself. And if you look at those elements, those seven elements they have raised, or eight, they have already been covered by Kunle and Mary. So my approach is to take this from my background. What is my background? I'm a marketing person, and I want to focus everything about career around marketing. And that's one aspect that Kunle brought out, and I want to develop on that instead of repeating what others have said. And it's all about you. And your career choice is a strategic decision. It's not something you just wake up and decide. You think about it. Unfortunately, many young people, right from the age, don't think about it. And you ask many people, what do you want to become, or what do you want to do? Even in the final year in university, they don't know. Many people come out of university after youth service, they're on the road looking for a job. And they come to you and say, what do you want? You say, I want any job. Any job is no job. Eventually, you can be sure that such a person is not clear in her mind or in his mind what he really wants to be in life. It does not matter what you read in the university. I know many people tell you, well, jam did not favor me. That's what we say. And as such, I am now reading this course. I wanted to read medicine, but I find myself reading chemistry or zoology. And that's it. What will I become? I have made brilliant accountants out of those who found themselves in such positions. Because they just believe, zoology, chemistry, what will I do? And today they are different people. From chemistry, you got a blue icon. What would I give you? A combination of a first degree and a professional qualification in accounting. And it changes completely the way you see life, the way you track your career. I started off as a mechanical engineer. On the way, I became the best friend of housewives. For two reasons. I helped them look after their children, and also helped them look after their husbands. And today, I'm a teacher. So you can see different career paths, but moving in the same direction. The starting point, you see, regardless of whom you are, your age, your position, the business you happen to be, we must understand the need and the importance of career planning. I am too old to read. No. I am too old to dabble into this. No. There are people who have actually gone into business after retirement with different zeal, different energy. So no matter your age, no matter your position, no matter where you find yourself in, still think of career planning as something important for you. And the starting point for this is your vision. If you ask two children what they want to be in life at the age of 10, one tells you, want to be a doctor when I grow up. Is that a vision? It is. If the second child now tells you, I want to be Superman, I know why. He spends all his time watching KTV. That's Cartoon Network. Which of them is vision? Which of them is fantasy? Superman is fantasy. Oh, huh? Why is it fantasy? Huh? It's not existence. It's not realistic. It's not achievable. But then I say, I want to be a doctor. Means he has a dream. He has a vision. And that's me is, what do I want to be in life? At what stage should I think of it? And one way of moving that forward is to have a mission statement. How many of us here have visions? Written vision statement and mission statement. How many? Just a handful. You see, we believe that it's only top organizations that think of that. You are an organization. And that's the reason why I will focus purely on looking at you as a brand.
What is your favorite toothpaste? What is your favorite planet soap? The bird? So the question is, why do you choose this? Why? Can I give you a reason why you choose the toilet, the toothpaste you choose for the toilet soap?
I started with
it from bed. You started with?
From bed.
From bed?
Yeah.
That's what your parents do for you.
Yeah.
And it works for you.
Yeah.
So that your parents are a little bit of that mind, made up your mind as to the brand you should use.
Yes.
How about soft drink?
Coke.
Huh?
Coke.
Why cook? Why cook? Somewhere along the line, somewhere in your mind, you've made up your mind that this is the best subject. And it's power of branding. And for me, I would like you to look at your career planning as the most important thing being how you can brand yourself. See your job as that of chief marketing officer of that brand called you. It is simple, but it's also hard. What do you think I did it as commercial director of Capri? What is spending all the time doing? Huh?
Rebranding?
Creating new products for people to buy. So, can you be a brand? If you're a brand and you're marketing yourself, what do you want to achieve? If you're a brand, what do you want to achieve? Say, I want to market myself. Goodwill. Why is goodwill important? Get attention. Get accepted. Get respected, get employed, and then be moved as the best material that can deliver on something. Does that fit? The good news is that all of us have opportunity of doing that. A brand, a successful brand, stands out. A successful brand is patronized. A successful brand has a good image. A successful brand is liked. So you also have opportunity to stand out. And to stand out, there are so many things you have to do. You have to learn, you have to improve, you have to build up the skills. And just as your favorite soft drink, or your favorite beer, or your favorite shirt is important to you and stands out and is remarkable, you also have the chance of being a brand that is worthy of demand. But you also ask yourself the question, how can I do it? You get hired on a new job. You report for work. You meet your colleagues, your new colleagues for the first time. What would you do? How do you start building that brand? First thing, you should start by figuring out how to deliver value to your customers. In your place of work, who is your customer? Pardon? Good, who are your internal customers? Your colleagues. And who are your top of external customers? The first thing you say, how do I deliver value? How can I be of use to your customers? No matter the industry. Along the way, you have to learn a few things. Remember, I want to deliver value. I have to learn how to develop my skills. Those skills that enable me to deliver value to my final customer. I have to learn how to use my ability to deliver that value. And I have to learn how to move from one project to the other. Because everything we do in life, at home, workplace, can actually be broken down into projects. Children's education is a project. Moving from one house to another is a project. Building a new house is a project. And we can challenge ourselves that way, saying, I need to learn how to do that. But one of the most important things you should start thinking of at that stage is, how do I distinguish myself from all the other smart people in the team? Don't forget that all of us there have earned the right to work in that organization. But how do I distinguish myself? What makes me different? How can I be the Apple within there? Or how can I be the Samsung Galaxy within that collection of handsets? You also have to figure out what it takes to create a distinctive role for yourself. It is not, I have been given this job. So, I'll just do it. How do you create that distinctive role for yourself? And I got very again from the marketing people. A nice statement. What message do I need to promote myself? I call it message I'm trying to promote myself. That's the brand. And there are simple, simple things you can do. Let me start by saying, please don't see yourself as an employee or human resource. Another number. Another headcount. Take three big layers. Building a house. The first one was asked, what are you doing? Can't you see that we are laying bricks? The second was asked, what are you doing? Well, we are building a house.
And the third one was us. They all did the same thing. What are you doing? Say, I am part of a team that is building what will turn out to be the best building in Lagos. Three people doing the same thing. Three different views of what they do. Which is most compelling of the three? Huh? The third, why is that compelling? One part of a bigger picture, what else? He can see where that work is leading them to. What? And you'll be in hot demand. Is that possible? Huh? That is possible. If you look down and say that I am a cleaner, who wants me? A company in Nigeria became a multinational company from cleaning. Have you heard of a company called Ola Clean? What do they do? Huh? Clean office, but better as a washerman. Huh? But what's the nice name for washerman? Dry cleaner. So from dry cleaning into clean offices, and believe it or not, even in cleaning pipelines. Petroleum pipeline, gas pipeline, all of a sudden from cleaning to a big multinational business. So don't be defined by your job title. I am the marketing manager. What does that mean? My job is only to focus on marketing. That's the thing of my job. If I also confine myself by my job description, I should not go beyond that. What I mean by that, when you don't confine yourself, is that go beyond that. Why should you go beyond that? It's not poking your nose in what others do, but understanding what others do. How does my job as marketing manager affect those in production? Affect those in finance? Affect those in HR? How can we relate? How can they see me as somebody whom they can trust, who can also help them on their job? And the reason why I said that, you should remember something, that you don't belong to any company or line. There's something called loyalty. The longer you stay in a company, the more respected you become. After 10 years, you get what? Gold wristwatch? Long side of the world? After 20 years? You see, in the banking industry, the bankers have proven to us that a rolling stone does what? Gathers. But we are told that a rolling stone does not gather. So it means that, yes, it's good to think of loyalty, but at the same time, don't forget that it's you, that is the company. So you don't in any way belong to any company or life. You should also ask yourself, every successful brand has something that makes it successful. It could be unique in the way it is designed. So ask yourself the question, what is it that my product or service, that is you, what you do that makes a difference? Is it how you do the job? Is it how you relate with your colleagues? Is it how you relate with your customers? Is it how you tackle the problems of the organization? Try and identify the qualities or characteristics that make you distinctive from your colleagues. There are. All of you are not the same. And even when you think all of you are the same, what else can I have that could differentiate me? What else can I add that could differentiate me? And the marketing people have this model. They talk of future and benefits. They tell you that consumers don't buy futures. They buy benefits. So you don't go to somebody and say, I have a very large oven, a very large cooker with large oven. That's a future. If you don't have a cooker that can enable you to cook for 100 people at the same time, he will listen to you. Or my bank has 700 branches. If those branches cannot talk to themselves, well, it's a future. But if I have 200 branches and you have an account in one branch, you can get your money anywhere. That's a benefit. So you can relate that to yourself. My degree is a future. You have a first degree, a second degree, you have a professional qualification, it's a future. What benefits can that translate to? If all of us have the same qualification, so we all have the same future, but we are all not delivering the same benefits. So how can I convert my future to benefits that will make me stand out and better than my I'll call them colleagues, not competitors. And you ask yourself another question, what have you done to make yourself stand out? Those who are not busy tend not to know how to manage their time because they spend more time procrastinating than getting things done. Part of that brand building is to nurture your own network. Network inside, but most importantly, network outside. Say, show me your friends, and I'll tell you who you are. But not just friends. That network should also include those you regard as a mentor. Those you regard as that can shape your future for you. But those who at any time will be willing to listen to you. Listen to you because they enjoy your company, because they feel they are adding value to your life, because they see you as somebody who is focused and trying to make a headway in life. You have to also act like a credible leader. It's a whole talk of leadership. Many of us point fingers up there. Who up? Either president or governor or CEO. All of us are leaders in our own fields, in our own strengths. We are all leaders in our homes. We are all leaders in our town hall associations. We are all leaders in our own professional association. But even where you don't have people under you, we are also leaders of ourselves, leading from within. You have to lead yourself first in order to be able to lead people. So when you think of your career, one of the issues we always think of, linear progression. You should not think of that in your career. Your career should be, you know what a checkerboard is? You know what a draft, for those of you, the men play draft. Huh? You know what that or even means? Don't always look at, I must move in a linear way. Think of moving sideways, sometimes in order to get to your destination. Remember I said, what's your vision? Sometimes you also have to think of even moving backwards. I have a friend who became the managing director of a company. He didn't join that company as managing director. He actually took a pay cut to move from a company where he was to another company. And we told him to make that move because that move was a better career move in the sense that in that organization,
he could find a clear career path that would lead him to the path. Whereas in the organization where he came from, he was virtually at what you call bar, not at the bar. And the only way he could make any move was to pray that the tsunami would happen at the top, and then he could displace a few people. So sometimes you may have to move backwards when it makes sense. You can also have to talk of moving diagonally. So don't always have at the back of your mind that I must move in a linear way. But whatever it is, one thing that is critical, which is important, is that you must find a way of reinventing yourself on a regular basis. Why is it important to reinvent yourself? Environments are changing every day. Nigeria is a turbulent environment. The way people do businesses are changing. Today, there are people who don't go, who end their living in their bedroom. They don't get up until 9 o'clock in the morning or 10. And don't go anywhere. And they make comfortable living. You know what they do? Some of them are bloggers. You know who a blogger is? Huh? Just write. And as long as they have followership, write on something. Write on fashion. Write on food. Write on taking care of children. Write on anything. As long as you have followership, before you know it, 10,000, 100,000, even 1 million people follow your blog. That's big business. You know what? You can walk up to L'Oreal and say, well, I have 500,000 young ladies who follow me every day. That's an opportunity for you to reach them. They start advertising on your blog. There are people who sit down at home and work in organizations because technology has made it possible. They don't have to report every day. There are people who stay in different parts of the country and belong to the management team of a company, and they meet every Monday using technology. So if you don't reinvent yourself and you can fit into such an environment, you find that you become a dinosaur. You become yesterday's news. And one way of making sure you reinvent yourself is for you to review your mission statement every 6 months. I didn't say rewrite. Review. I say, am I working towards my mission statement? Do I need to tweak it a little bit? As you struggle in this battle of saying, what do I want to be? How do I want to make a headway in my career? I would like you to measure yourself against these four things. First, am I a great team player? And that means, am I supportive? Do I support my colleagues? Do I treat them as my competitor? Or do I treat them as my internal customer? Am I an exceptional expert at something that has value? What is it? Am I a visionary leader? Do I look at the future? Or am I interested in living each day to the fullest? Am I a business person? By this, I don't mean that you are running your own business, but in where I work, do I look at what I do from a business perspective? Can I make a business case for whatever I do? What are the benefits? What are the costs? Benefits may not even translate to Naira. Benefits could be things that will make it possible for the organization to make a headway, and in the future will generate that Naira. We are always worried about how we move in life. And because of that, many of us focus all our energy looking at our profession.
And then the message I have for you as you leave here today, please never get so busy making a living that you forget to make a life. None of you here can stand on one leg for up to an hour unless you practice yoga. Any yoga student here? Okay? So can you imagine standing on one leg? Even standing on two legs for a long time is wahala. And that's the reason why animals on four legs are more stable than those of us on two legs. So in terms of your own life, think of four legs, not two legs. Because that's where you can get that work-life balance. And the four legs, see, your spiritual life, your social life, otherwise I'm not going to hear those networks, your professional life, and also your physical life, your health. Many of us work so hard, focusing on our professional life, that we tend to neglect our physical life. And if you open newspapers every day and look at the obituary, you'll be shocked that at 30-something, at 20-something, at 40-something, you're hearing, oh, sudden death, cardiac arrest, stroke, you name it. And all because, in the bid to make a living, we forget to make a life. So whatever it is, you can only make a headway in life if you look at those four legs. Never stand on one leg, because you are looking for a sustainable way of living your life and not a short-term way. Short-term way is when you focus only on professional, but sustainable way when you look at those four legs. Thank you very much.